now we are going to talk about adhikarana, the importance of the context. So if we have a word, let's say prakriti, in the Shad Darshanas, the philosophies of Sankhya, Vaisheshika, Yoga, and so on. Or if we have the word prakriti in Ayurveda, in the Sutrasthana of the Ashtanga Hridaya. Or if we have the word prakriti in the Uttarasthana or whatever. One thing that for me was maybe the biggest thing I learned with Randas, this group of classes that we took, is that look, if you don't know the name of the chapter the person is talking about, it's not possible to say what that word means. So please, Randas, show us a little bit about the importance of adhikarana.
Certainly. Adhikarana is the tantrayukti. Among the 36 tantrayukti, the very first tantrayukti and very prior tantrayukti, even when you apply the other tantrayuktis also. Leaving the adhikarana, you cannot understand the textbook, there is no doubt in that one. Suppose, as he told, prakriti is the word. If you take prakriti in general in literature, prakriti is nature. It is something related to the nature and the plants, growing, environment and etc. But when you take Ayurveda, the prakriti entirely changes, it comes to a person, an individual, a purusha. And when you take the term atma, in a philosophy, atma, paramatma, jivatma, they are having very larger sense and very big senses. But when you come to Ayurveda, atma is chetana, is the life that which exists inside the body of the person. The body is that which is made up of the panchamahabhuta, and the chetana, atma, is giving the life to that body. So for Ayurvedic people, atma is chetana. See, that is the context. Ayurveda science is the context where the atma is just chetana. Purusha, if you take a general term, purushaha means a man is the meaning. But when you take the Ayurveda purusha, purusha is no one but a person who is having panchabhautika body and atma as the chetana in his body. So that is what is purusha in Ayurveda. So adhikarana, this is dirganjeevaniyam adhyayam. If you take dirganjeevaniyam adhyayam, that chapter gives the basic knowledge for a person who wanted to have a long life. Unless and until you know the chapter's name, the words in that one you may not be able to understand. You have to understand the enlisting of guna, relating that to this gunas I am going to use for a long life. Then only the meaning of that guna will be properly understood. Guru is the guna. Guru, heavy, is the meaning. But as far as Ayurveda, first chapter, dirganjeevaniyam, when you take Aishkamiyam adhyayam, when you take, it is giving, guru is brahmane shaktihi. It is for developing the brahmana, nourishment in the body. You just imagine, guru is heavy, but here it is brahmane shakti. How it has been changed. So the adhikarana is very, very important in learning the sciences.
Yes, let me make an observation about this. When we are studying Hemadri texts, the commentary of Ashtanga Hridaya, when we are learning Guru Manda Himas Nigda Slakshnamrit, no, not Sandramridosiraha Guna Sasukshma Vishadavin Shati Savipareha, we stopped there and we went to the what is the karma of each guna. And this was not in Ashtanga Hridaya. This was in a book that is Arunadatta commentary. What is the name? Sarvanga
Sundara.
Sarvanga Sundara. And this is not available in English.
Yeah.
Sorry to say.
Yeah.
The Germans did not translate it yet.
Yeah.
So the point is that when we are discussing about Ritucharya, we are now studying Ritucharya.
Yeah.
I said, look, Randas, it doesn't make sense to me. I think it's this. And he said, look, what is the name of the chapter? The name of the chapter is Ritucharya, right? Yes. So in this, we are discussing after what? We are discussing after Dinacharya, right? And this, we are discussing after what? Ayushkamiyam, right? So what is the point they are underlying this is the dosha. So if it's not going barefoot, it was the our point of debate. It's not about his security, because the chapter there is dealing about the effects of the doshas. You can say that this is also can be a reason for not going barefooted in this kind of harsh situation. But if you don't understand what is the context that is being done there, you are going to have some ideas that can be feasible, but it's not the way that the acharyas were expecting you to read. They were expecting that you were properly trained in Tantrayukti. They were expecting that you were properly trained in Sanskrit. So they were not reading just commentaries of people that you have the Charak Sanhita or whatever in the, when it's good they have in the Devanagari.
Yeah.
And it's just like in AST or some transliteration. But we are reading mainly, I would say in the West, the translation in English. And we are taking for granted that this is what we should learn about Charaka, Ashtanga Hridaya. Our teacher, Sanjay, was promoting this effort to bring forth the translation of Ashtanga Hridaya with all five or six commentaries of Ashtanga Hridaya. He did the first volume, but the point is, we are very far away from the ideal method of learning Ayurveda, where you know well Sanskrit before you start to learn Ayurveda, and before you start learning Ayurveda, you know the cultural background of Puranas and so on, itihasas.
Sure.
So, in this way, Ayurveda was taught after a Gurukula process. So, now we can go to a Gurukula point of discussion.